welcome to NES Game Reviews. Now, back when we were younger, we probably all had things like our favorite sports teams, our favorite artists. I personally didn't, but more relevant to this video, we probably all had our favorite movie actor, movie genre, at least at some point. Admittedly, when I was younger, I was a big fan of Jim Carrey and most of his movies, and today I still am for the most part. But being that I was more into some comedies, I was never really into action movies when I was younger. So I never really saw movies like Terminator or Rambo when I was younger, and for the most part, today, I still haven't. I'll let you heckle for a second there. So, where am I getting with all this? Well, I never really saw any films starring Jackie Chan, as I wasn't into action movies. I mean, the closest I ever gotten to Jackie Chan was... And that's stretching things a bit. More to the point, back when I was in elementary school, which predates Pokemon, trust me, I actually picked up this book, which has definitely seen better days now, and while flipping through it, found a game that looked a little strange. I mean, the main character, it didn't really look like the main characters I was used to. I was always used to games back then with characters like Mario or Link who are really small on the screen. So I come across this one, and the game looked good, but I was a little concerned about the main character because it's a little larger than what I was used to, so I figured it was one of those just thrown together games. Fast forward several years, and I finally got the chance to pick up the game. Can't find it in the darn book now. Anyways, fast forward a couple years, finally got the chance to pick up the game. And I must say, I was definitely impressed by it. It's definitely one of the more underrated games, I think, for the NES. A little more underrated than Crystalis. But to this day, I would probably consider it one of my top 10 games I'd pull out and just play at any time on the NES. So, basically, we're going to go ahead and take a look at Jackie Chan's Action Kung Fu for the NES. Yeah, like I said, this book's seen better days. Jackie Chan's Action Kung Fu, screw it. Jackie Chan was released by Hudson in 1990 on the NES, and was ported to the TurboGrafx-16 in 1991. There are differences between the two versions that I'm going to explain later, but for this review, I'm going to be focusing on the NES version. Sorry, TurboGrafx owners. Jackie and his twin sister, Josephine, were two of China's best kung fu fighters. Everything was fine until their master's archenemy, the Sorcerer, our original, appeared and cast a spell to make Josephine disappear, believing that only having one of the twins around wouldn't be much of a threat to him. The game takes place over 5 stages, each stage with several areas before facing off against a boss. As a master of the martial arts, you have quite a few moves at your disposal. Your basic attacks are a punch, done by hitting B, a jump kick, which is done by jumping and hitting B, and a low kick, done by crouching and hitting B. The key letter here is B. You can also gain a few special attacks by collecting power-ups by defeating frogs. Yes, frogs. I'll let that sink in for a minute. Hitting a frog will either give you a bowl that replenishes health, or one of a few special attacks. The 180-degree kick, the 360-degree kick, the sky attack, and the tornado attack. The 180-degree and 360-degree attacks are practically the same thing. They're both spin kicks. Just one rotates a little more than the other and lasts a little longer. The sky attack is kind of like a Pele kick in soccer, but it kicks straight up instead of behind you. Finally, the tornado attack makes you roll in the air for a short length of time, during which you're completely invincible. Come to think of it, I think you're invincible during any of the special attacks. However, you're only given a limited number of uses for each, 9 for the 180-degree spin kick, and 7 for the others, so use them sparingly. As stated, each stage has several areas, and the final one of the stage ends in a boss battle. Most areas are the typical left to right side scrollers, but a couple have you going vertically up the screen, while 2 areas, and part of another area, are auto-scrollers. Each stage also has enemies that are typically unique to that stage, but a few areas have some recurring enemies. Most enemies are taken down with a couple hits and really aren't anything special after knowing how they attack. In fact, a good part of the game is the patience to know when to attack and when to let them attack first. There are a couple of things I haven't talked about yet that I probably should. The first one is that you actually have another attack that's pretty powerful, yet limited. The Psycho Wave. This is the charge shot that's charged up by holding down B for a couple of seconds, then releasing it to unleash an energy wave straight ahead. However, you can only store up to 5, and I don't believe they refill between stages. However, you can refill them yourself in one of two ways. The first is done by collecting green orbs that drop from enemies. Yeah, do you ever wonder what those things were for? Well, collecting 30 of them will refill your life and your psycho waves. Granted, collecting 30 may not seem like much, but keep in mind that if you get a game over, which I'll talk about in a bit, you'll lose all the orbs you have. The other way to refill your psycho waves are the bonus stages, which is actually the other thing in general I wanted to talk about. Scattered throughout the game are several bonus stages, and as far as I'm aware, each one is different. The problem is, I've only found 3, and I can only get 2 of them to appear on demand. It seems they appear when you jump in or on a certain spot, I'm not sure. But I can't get all of them to appear every time. But it seems like they go in a specific order. That is to mean that if you get the first bell, say in the first stage, you're always going to get the cloud bonus stage. Then no matter where you get the second bell, you're always going to be attacking wooden dummies. When you get the third, you're going to be attacking fish. Again, I'll let that sink in for a minute. But, anyways, each bonus stage has you completing a specific task, and the better you do, the more points you earn. These points are then converted into the bonuses at the end of each stage. Bonus stage, rather. But there's a catch. You don't get to choose what gets refilled when. First, the game refills your life if needed. Next, you get any continues, and then if you have any points left, it goes towards the psycho waves. Yes, the cheapest thing gets refilled last. Wrap your head around that. So, yes, the game does have lives, but they act more like continues. Once you die, you get a game over, and you go back to the title screen. However, if you have any continues remaining, you can begin from the area in which you died. You start off with 5 continues and can pick up more from the bonus stages as mentioned previously. This... Actually, I'm a little confused as to why they did it like this. Again, the continues are basically lives in how they work. It just would have made more sense if they just treated them like lives and just sent you back to the beginning of the area instead of going back to the title screen. I mean, if I really wanted to start the game from scratch again, would just take me 2 seconds to reach over and hit the reset button on the NES. Still, it's not a major complaint, just something that doesn't make much sense. Much like Crystalis, I love the music in this game. It always feels energetic and just has a good sound to it. Is it strange that I'd rather listen to awesome 8-bit music over the orchestral music of the DAES games? Then again, Hudson games tend to have decent music. I've always liked the music from Adventure Island games, and I know I'm going to get a lot of flack for this. I even like the music from Mylon's Secret Castle. Yes, I'm a fan of that game. Maybe I'll review that game later this year. Gotta make a mental note. That's really all there is to this game. There are a couple other things, though, I do want to mention. I did mention there were some differences between the TurboGrafx version and the NES version. Aside from graphical differences, obviously, and the audio quality is a little better, a couple of the main differences are some of the stage layouts I've heard are different. Stages 4 and 5 have new mid-bosses now. It takes more of the green orbs to refill your energy and psycho waves. I think it takes 100 from what I've read in the TurboGrafx version, but some enemies also drop, or can drop, several of the orbs. Well, some, I guess, can drop none. One of the other differences I noticed while watching a video, and most of these differences I've got from either watching a video or reading Wikipedia, is that there may be one or two different attacks. Like, one of the special attacks I saw in a video I watched of the TurboGrafx version was some sort of, like, little sweeping kick, so to speak. I guess you can kind of combine it. Kind of like combining your normal crouching kick with like a 180 kick or 360 kick, something like that. But beyond that, the differences between the two are minor. Now, there is something I do want to do with the game, or do want to do with this review of the game. And I did get a chance to do with Chris Dallas, is to actually kind of go through and give a few little tips, I guess, for the bosses, so to speak, because for the most part, you won't really need them, but I figured, what the heck. Before I get into that, though, I do want to add something to this real quick. So this is the fun of me recording these videos, because I usually do the voiceovers first for the footage scenes, and then I go ahead and record these camera parts. And in between, I started recording the first camera part that you've already watched, where I talk about this book. And as I was talking and I got to the part about the book, I realized, crap, I don't have the book out, let alone the game. So I dug through my closet, found the book, which, like I said, has seen better days. And while reading through this, I actually found a stage select code, which I did not know about. Which, this really helps in getting footage. So, for those interested, really quickly, the stage select code is on the title screen. Press up, up, down, down. No, it's not the Konami code. Up, down, B, A, B, then start. And you can choose stage 1 through 5. The book does say that the manual sin for 99 continues doesn't seem to work. I never tried it. But now that I mentioned that, there are a couple... The reason why I'm bringing this up is I do want to mention a couple little disclaimers, so to speak, or a couple little add-ins to my previous voiceover work on the footage scenes that I mentioned in there. And while playing around, while going straight to stage 5, using the stage select code just a little bit ago, I found out a couple things I didn't know about, or rather, clarified. The first is the bonus stages. I think I mentioned that the bonus stages, you do kind of have to jump in or hit certain spots in the stage. That seems to be true, because I actually decided to just kind of jump around almost everywhere on stage 5, and came across two bonus stages. Now, I don't know if they go in a cycling order, or if they are preset. So as in, like, you have, like, if you're to take every single stage, lay them all out, and show on the layout where every single bell is, the first bell, the game will always take you to the cloud stage, second to the fighting the wooden dummies, the third to the fish, and then as far as I'm aware, it cycles. So it's not like the first one you find will always take you to the cloud stage, the second one you find will always take you to the wooden dummies. It is predetermined what bonus stage it goes to, as far as I can tell. The other thing I did want to mention, we haven't really gotten to it yet, but it'll be when we talk about the bosses. You're going to hear me mention a line where I said I've only beaten the final boss once. That is no longer true. Now that I've had a chance to work my way back up to stage 5 by using the stage select code and got to the final bosses, I did just recently, again, finish off the stage 5 boss. So I will be getting some more footage of that, so you're going to be seeing that. And I will be, I'm just going to say right now, since the footage parts are already done, I don't think there's really much more of a disclaimer to throw in there about the bosses. So what you'll hear in the next segment when I talk about the bosses is pretty much going to be it. But I do want to throw this one little thing out real quickly. Actually, you know what? No. The last thing I was going to mention, I'm going to wait until the final camera segment to talk about, because it actually is a bit of a hint on how to beat the final boss, and I really don't want to go back and re-record that entire section again. So, with that, that's pretty much going to take care of my little disclaimers here. Again, the last thing I mentioned, I will talk about when it gets time to wrap things up. So, with that, let's go ahead and see what we can do about these bosses, shall we? If you're looking to speedrun this game, there's a little tactic you can use to speed things up a bit. When you do a jump kick, the animation doesn't necessarily end when you hit the ground or an enemy. In fact, it always seems to last for a certain amount of time, and you can do this to kind of add another attack to your arsenal, a slide kick. When you jump, wait until you're about to hit the ground to hit B. You'll still do your jump kick as you hit the ground, but you'll also keep your forward momentum and slide along the ground a bit. This is useful for speedrunning the game, as you don't stop when doing this attack, whereas if you punch while running, you actually stop. With that out of the way, let's talk about the bosses. First off, if you have any psycho waves left when you reach a boss, that's the time to use them. For the first three bosses, the psycho wave basically tears them apart. They may not defeat them outright, but they will lead them to a point that a few normal attacks will do the trick, or a couple special attacks. However, if you want to fight the normal way, here's some help to, well, help you. The first boss isn't that hard regardless, though it can be a little tricky. You simply want to jump on one of the columns, then jump towards the other side and attack its head. The problem is, the hands will tend to hit you for using normal attacks, so special attacks will help out here. And since you find several on each stage, you might want to use them here. I find the sky attack quite useful here, but then again, any of them work, and since you're invincible during any of the uses of them, the hands won't really hit you, because you'll be done with your animation long once you're past the hands. For the stage 2 boss, this can get a little trickier, but you just kind of want to reverse the tactics. But, I mean, for the stage 1 boss, if you have any special attacks, use them right away. For the stage 2 boss, the first thing he does, he just kind of takes his staff and just keeps beating the ground with it. And whenever he does, 3 fireballs raise up from random points on the ground. As long as you stand right about here, you can keep jumping and kicking him, and that'll get you past the first phase. Once the stick starts, I really don't know what to call that, flashing, I guess? Then the staff's gonna start randomly bouncing around the room. This is when you want to use your special attacks. Particularly, the tornado attack works pretty well, as you can use it to go right through the staff and end up somewhere on the other side of it. The stage 3 boss can be a little tricky, but just remember that the stuff between the platforms is water, not a bottomless pit, so you can safely stand in it. Again, use any special attacks you have first, and if you have any psycho waves, of course, use them. The fourth boss is a bit trickier, as you're constantly bouncing around on the clouds and dodging the hand that comes up. Add to that the fact you can only hit the boss in the eyes when they're open, and this boss is really about patience. If you have any psycho waves when you get to this point, burn them. But make sure to wait until the eyes are open. Even after going through all 5 of them and any special attacks, you may still have to use a couple normal attacks to finish them off. Just remember to be patient. Am I the only one who this boss reminds them of the Wind Elemental in Iron Sword? Ah well. The fifth boss, not counting the dragons you find in Stage 5, can be tricky unless you can get him into a pattern. If you can get this pattern down, do not use any psycho waves on him, or any special attacks. Trust me, you will need them for the final boss. Basically, you'll want to jump in and do a jump kick. Then wait for him to jump away. Wherever he jumps to, get away from him. If you're far enough away, he'll fire off a charge shot. But if you're too close, he'll do a quick melee attack. I think I've had it a few times in which after doing a charge shot, he jumps back a bit and does another attack. But if you can get him into this pattern, you're pretty much set. However, this is a long battle. Even if you exhaust all your psycho waves and special attacks, which again, once you learn this pattern, don't use them. So, about that final boss. Yeah, it's right after this fifth boss. That's why I said don't burn your psycho waves and special attacks. The final boss is a giant spider. You know the drill. I'm going to let you let that sink in. If you have any psycho waves, use them. If you have any special attacks, use them. If you manage to get past the previous boss without doing either, you're doing good. Otherwise, this is going to be a tricky battle. I've only gotten past this boss once, and I'm still not sure how that happened. Basically, he's going to throw stuff out at you that kind of homes in on you. I think they can be taken out, which is good because they're harder than heck to avoid. Just get in any attacks when you can. Again, if you have Psycho Waves, stay away and just fire them off. It's not that hard to get the Psycho Waves to hit. Same with the special attack, just hopefully if you have the tornado attack, just be careful, because the boss doesn't really leave the right side of the screen if I recall. So that's pretty much it about this game. There are a couple things I didn't mention before, so I'll go ahead and mention them now. First, when I was talking about the controls, there was one thing I didn't mention, and that was you can hold down when you're jumping to kind of drop down a little faster. And this can be useful if you want to land in a certain spot, but keep in mind that you can still kind of steer to the left and right, and you can accidentally overshoot or undershoot where you're landing, so it's not exactly foolproof. Another thing I wanted to mention was a couple of other little things I missed in my disclaimers in the previous camera segment. I mentioned in one of the footage segments that I didn't really see much of a difference between the 180 degree and 360 degree spin kicks, other than one rotates you around a little more and lasts a little longer, and of course you're invincible during your special attacks. Now, it turns out there is a bit of a difference, but I never really had a chance to test it out, because I was never in a situation to test it out. Apparently, the 360 degree spin kicks can take out enemies behind you. Granted, I was never in a situation where I had an enemy behind me, maybe with the exception of the little flying skull things that kind of come across the screen, go up, come back. But even then, I just kept moving. So I never really had a situation where I could test that. The other thing is, I mentioned in the previous camera segment that I had mentioned in the footage segment you just watched, if you shouldn't follow that, that I had only beaten the final spider boss once. And I mentioned in the previous camera segment that between recording the camera segments and the footage segments and all that, I was able to beat him again. So I do have a bit more of a strategy now for how that final boss fight plays out. First, the original strategy still stands. If you have any Psycho Waves, burn them. If you have any special attacks, burn them. After you do beat the fifth boss, and before you go to the final boss, you technically rescue Josephine, and she will give you a life refill. I know she doesn't give you a special attack refill, and I don't think you get a Psycho Wave refill. So if you can lock the fifth boss down in that jumping pattern, keep him there. Try not to use any special attacks if you can avoid it. I can't recall if Josephine gives you a full life refill or not, because I only had two hits on me, and those were both refilled by Josephine, so. But when you do get to the spider boss, I had to use one of two attacks while it moved up and down the screen on me. Again, it never moved left or right, just up or down. The two attacks, the first one, which I think I only used once on me, was it fired like a three-way split shot. That's easily avoidable by just moving up or down. The other attack, which it used the rest of the time, was like a little boomerang scythe blade or something, like a little... This is going to sound really strange. If you've seen the Pokemon animated series, think Razor Leaf. That's honestly what I think of. So it pretty much throws it, and it kind of tracks where you're at, so you can kind of go around in a circle, or like a half circle, before it disappears. As far as I know, you cannot take it out. But if you do go and kind of follow, like, or make it follow you in a little half circle, you should be able to go ahead and get in an attack on the boss, before it fires out another one and quickly get back. And you can pretty much keep that up. Again, though, if you've got Psycho Waves and special attacks, burn them. If not, you're in for a rough fight. I still barely got out of there alive. So that's pretty much all there is to the game. So I get things in position. It's a fun game. It's another underrated one, let's put it that way. It's not as underrated as, I mean, I'm sorry, it's more underrated than Crystalis, I believe. It's not as well known. Because while I do think Crystalis is an underrated game at times, it may not quite get the exposure it should. I think a lot more people have heard of Crystalis than Jackie Chan's Action Kung Fu. And it always seems to be the underrated games I like playing a lot. I mean, it's simple. It's kind of short, so you can probably go through it in an hour or so. Again, the music in the game is just phenomenal. I posted on my Facebook page a while back a... I guess you can put like a little teaser clip of one of the songs. There's one of the songs that you hear a couple times in the game. I'm sure you've heard it in this review too. What really gets me though about this game is that because it was made by Hudson, I guess is the best way to start that, someone actually took a TV or a movie franchise or an actor or someone, turned it into a video game, and it didn't suck. You want to know why it didn't suck? I will tell you why this game didn't suck. See that? That says Hudson Soft. That does not say LJN. Yes, if you are a fan of the Angry Video Game Nerd, I'm sure you've seen his videos where he does some LJN games. A couple of the X-Men games I know he's done. The Terminator series. He even, I think, did his NES accessory review. He didn't really look at Beetlejuice, but he's trying to use the, I think it was a Rolling Rocker that was made by LJN. He said, okay, let's try with an LJN game, which he pulled out Beetlejuice. And Beetlejuice may not be the worst LJN game, but LJN games as a whole tend to kind of suck unless they're based on game shows.
I'll tell you right now,
if this game had been made by LJN, I probably wouldn't be reviewing it right now. I'd wait until I would want to review a bad game. I will say, though, if you do want to try to find this game, and if you're a fan of the NES and fan of platformers, I definitely recommend trying to find it. I mean, it's not the rarest game, but as you can tell, I pay about $13 for this. Cartridge only. I imagine if you were to find the game with the manual in the box, you could probably go for upwards up to 20 or 30. And to be honest, if I saw this complete in box, manual, everything, I would almost be willing to pay about $20 or $30 for this. Because, I mean, I think $13 for cartridge only is not that bad. People are going to say, yeah, you can find it cheaper on eBay and stuff, but you know what? I think $13 is good for that game. It's right around that ballpark. Maybe, I mean, I couldn't see it for going much less than 10, but still, for what it's worth, it's good. So that just about wraps this up. And with that said, hopefully next month's review will be out within 2 to 3 weeks. Hopefully not at the end of the month again. I'm trying not to put these off to the end of the month, and I accidentally do. So hopefully this next review won't take that long. And I think my next review, I'm going to focus on another major franchise from when I was a kid. Now, I'm not saying Jackie Chan was a major franchise, but definitely a major actor in a major film genre. But, so another major aspect from my childhood that I wasn't into. The point is,
The next review will be another major franchise from my childhood. And it may not necessarily be something that everyone has experience with, but I can almost guarantee that everyone would know the name instantly. As soon as you hear the name, you're going to know it. Now, don't get me wrong, Jackie Chan is a fun game, and again, was real big back in the day, and why it still is. I mean, he's doing V8 commercials. About, well, Jackie Chan takes place in China, and Chris Dallas kind of took place in some sort of fantasy world. If you want to go back to Season 1, even Astyanax and Battle Kid were taking place in fantasy worlds. I think it's time to return to the United States for my next game. A game in which the main characters, I guess you could say, are real American heroes.